Hey, Matthew chapter number 14. Matthew chapter number 14. All right, Matthew chapter number 14. Got a good friend of mine here with me from visiting with me from Virginia. He comes every couple of years. Dean Salami sitting right there. He's a preacher right here. Dean right here. Now, he's been here before. I think this second, third time being here. But he comes to hang out with me just for 2 or 3 days. That's about as much as anybody can stand at any one time. And he goes back. But no, we enjoy great fellowship together, talking Bible and ministry and things like that. So, hey, Matthew chapter number 14, and we are looking at this perfecting storm, this storm that God used in the lives of these men, his men, to perfect that which was lacking in them, to complete that, to continue to work in that, in their lives. God is absolutely, you know, one of the working. The working premise is that God has begun a good work and he's going to perform it right in us. God is absolutely committed to my growth and my development. He's committed to my growth and my development as a believer. He's after Christ in me. Right? His great purpose is that I be conformed to the image of his dear son. That's what God is after. And so he allows and appoints difficult situations. Allows them, appoints them. It comes across the threshold of our lives. It's been allowed. It's been appointed. No accident. No coincidence. Providence. It is a reality, unmistakable, undeniable reality. And so this is a Christian storm, not a call storm. They did not disobey and end up in a storm like Jonah. This is not just a common storm, because we see that this was a storm that Jesus sent them into. This is a part of the what? Curriculum. For discipleship. When God is developing, he's not growing mushrooms that grow up overnight. He's developing trees, right? That man who is blessed of the Lord is like a tree that's planted by the rivers of water, planted, right? Founded and faithful, who has a root system that goes down. And that's what God is growing, not mushrooms, grow up overnight. And so, this storm was a part of their lives, designed by God, designed for them by God. So they fussed with Jesus a little bit. He constrained them to get in the boat. He sent the multitudes home to nice warm beds. This is what we've been talking about. The multitudes who had just finished a great meal was allowed to go home. And nice warm beds, nice. Comfortable evenings, but the men that God were going to use to turn the world around had to go through this storm, right? It was needful. What Peter says, if need be, you are in heaviness. If need be, necessary, the necessary nature of storms. This is a necessary nature. Why? Remember, they learned things here that they would not have known apart from the storm. We learned some things in difficulties that we just do not learn. You know enough about yourself that you don't learn a lot of stuff when you're on the mountain. Well, you don't learn a lot of stuff when you are in success. Right? In fact, success and attainment and achievement and accomplishment and all these things drunken us, make us, inebriates us, make us think that we have and we are more than what we really are. So God will allow these tests to form a testimony. God will allow. So here these men sit into this storm, very teeth of it, and they feel like they are at the mercy of this storm, verse 24, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. They looked to be at the mercy of the winds and the waves. They are at this point, desperate men. If you read Mark's account, they were straining at the oars. They were doing all they could, and yet it was to no avail, and they feel like they are at the mercy of the winds and the waves. And in the fourth watch, that darkest night, that darkest hour, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. Every word of this is pregnant with power and meaning. Jesus goes to them. Oftentimes you'll find out when you are at your extremities, right? When you can't go anymore, Jesus will come at the darkest hour. And what he'll come is he'll come demonstrating his supremacy and his sovereignty over our situations. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, there is Jesus whose feet are firmly planted on the waves that were over their head, right? It's over their heads, still under his feet. He's not just subject to the storm. He's sovereign over the storm. He's walking on the sea. They were troubled, saying it is a spirit, and they cried out for fear. Now, that word fear is a word that we'll talk about today. Fear, fear, fear. But straightway, immediately, Jesus spake unto them, right? The God who sent them into the storm, went to them in the storm, spoke to them in the storm. We pointed out that in Mark chapter number 6, the storm that jumped on those disciples when Jesus was in the back of the boat, these men were afraid. That was a storm. I mean, it was a formidable storm. The winds and the waves. It was a storm. But Jesus was in the back of with perfect peace, perfectly aligned with the Father. Right? So he's asleep. And in fact, when they wake Jesus, Jesus says, "Oh, ye of little faith." Now, why would they have little faith? Because Jesus says, "We're going over." Not we're going under, we're going over. Right? So like the word of Jesus was to be to them a comfort. Because if Jesus says we are, then we are. But they had little faith. They thought this storm was going to cause them to what? Perish. But Jesus then awakened, did what? Speak to the winds and the waves. Peace, be still. Like chiding disobedient children. Ah, knock it off. Right? You know how sometimes as parents you say, "Don't make me come over there." Jesus, in absolute control, rebuked the wind, rebuked the waves. But what do we say now? Why is this storm different from that storm? Because now Jesus in this storm says nothing to the winds and the waves. He's talking to who? To the believer. This is what God wants us to get to the place where we understand where real peace is hearing his words to us. We sing that song, "Blessed Quietness, Holy Quietness. What assurance to my soul on the stormy seas. He speaks peace to me." Not the winds and the waves, but to me. Right? So peace then, we understand in the final analysis, is not the absence of storms around us, but the absence of storms within us, right? The world can be falling apart around us, and we can still have peace on the inside. Jesus wants to speak that peace. He wants his word to bring peace to me, not necessarily to the winds and to the waves. Now, you and I don't like the winds and the waves, the howling winds, those menacing waves, that jagged lightning, that thunder, that stinging rain. They wanted it all gone. It's like me. I don't want this. We talked about this. I'm not signing up for this. But Jesus is speaking now to them, not to them. This is a graduate storm. This is a graduate school storm where we understand how to have peace in the midst of the trial. And so Jesus went to them. Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Be of good cheer." That is, take courage, take heart. It's me. Be not afraid. Now watch this. They were afraid because of what they thought they saw. They thought they saw a ghost, right? I mean, let's face it now, folks. When it's as bad as it was, the last thing you need is a ghost. Just when you think it can't get no worse, here come a ghost, right? But these men, they cry out. But here's my point. Their eyes failed them. Their eyes failed them. They did not know what they were seeing. Their eyes failed them. Our eyes will fail us in the storm. God is teaching his sheep to live by what? Faith and not by sight. Right? He's teaching us to learn how to hear my sheep know and hear my what? Voice. Remember that poem that I recited the other day? In spite of what thine eyes behold, in spite of what thy fears have told, still to his gracious promise hold and believe good things of God. In spite of what thine eyes behold, in spite of what your fears have told, still to his gracious promise hold, that promise that comes from his lips, that promise that comes into the ear of our soul, hold on to that. In spite of what thine eyes behold. See? So their eyes failed them. So Jesus speaks to them, and they hear his voice. And Peter hears his voice. And Jesus speaks these great words. It is I, be not afraid. Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, here the King James says, bid me, literally command me to come unto thee on the water. Everything so far has been outside the boat. But we get in the boat now, and there are 12 men inside this boat. And Jesus speaks to them, and maybe he didn't scream over the noise of the storm. Maybe he spoke under the noise of the storm, and they heard it. How many of you know that'll happen sometime? I mean, you know, there is a lot of noise in our ears. There's a lot of competing voices and competing sounds. And we have to learn like Elijah learned that God is not talking in the whirlwind. And he's not talking in the lightning, and he's not talking in the storm. He's what? In that little voice, that still small voice, where there is a place in the child of God where we can be still and know who God is. And he requires it of us. Kind of like be still and hear God talking to us, not screaming to us, not competing with all the noise and the nonsense of the world, but speaking to us in a voice that is still and quiet and low. We won't be able to hear unless we are being still. So he speaks to them, be not afraid. So Peter answered him, and you might imagine it would be Peter. And I love this about Peter. Peter does what everybody else is thinking. Peter asks the questions everybody else is thinking. Right? I love this about Peter. Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, command me, you tell me to come unto thee on the water. We've pointed this out before. I know over the time that I've been here that this is what real Bible faith looks like. Real Bible faith is not a presumption to tell God what's going to happen. Real Bible faith is not you saying, I'm going to name it and claim it. I see it, so I'm going to say it, right? I'm going to speak it into existence. Real Bible faith understands that God has to say something and I have to believe it. So Peter then says, I'm coming to you, Lord, since that's you, right? That's not faith. That's foolishness. Faith says, God, if you say it, I'll believe it. If you say it, I'll believe it. Not me name it and claim it, but what? You name it and I'll claim it. So Peter understood this. We have to understand that. So Peter says, Lord, if it's you, bid me come to thee on the water. And then Jesus gives a four-letter word. What? Come. Here's his word, come. Now, I want to just tell you this. That one word is enough for Peter to walk the whole length of that lake. That four-letter word, come. That's enough for Peter to walk the whole length of it. See? That's the word of God. Come. Not Peter telling God what he's going to do. He said, Lord, you tell me what to do, and I'll do it. You bid me come. You command me come. And Jesus says, come. And Peter says, me and my big mouth. Because now the word, I've said before, the word come is a challenge. Because it's going to challenge Peter beyond what Peter's ever done before. Faith, the word of God will often do that. Right? Life requires more of you than you're able. The word of God requires of you more than you're able. Right? In yourself. But let me just tell you this. The promise of God, the command of God is a promise of God. Come means you can. How many of you know that? Be not afraid means you can be not afraid. You follow what I'm saying? Every command of God is pregnant with promise. What he requires, he supplies. And Peter had all he needed to walk across that lake. He had this four-letter word, come. But it was a challenge to Peter. Okay? Because there are three things here in this storm that you, if you look at the thing here, three things. You had the ship, you had the storm, and you had the Savior. The ship, the storm, and the Savior. Peter's in the ship. And while the ship might not have been much, it was something. You follow me? So now Jesus is saying, come. Peter said, Lord, you bid me come. You command me come. And the Lord says, come. What a challenge to Peter now. You know why? Because Peter is going to have to unhand what he has. One of the things I know about storms, I have a friend of mine helped me through his personal storm. Is that God wants to give us more than what I got in my hand right now. He wants to give me something in my soul, right? And it might require me letting go of what's in my hand. You know what keeps us a lot of times from being stranded upon the omnipotence of God? Stuff we already got. You know what I'm talking about? This is our problem. I mean, our problem, listen, friends, we've got a real problem. Let me tell you what our problem is. A lack of desperation. You know why? Because we have resources and recourses. And we're never, the sense of being stranded upon God, it's kind of a lost concept to American Christianity, Western Christianity, where you can call and you got this, you got that. We got resources and we got recourses, and we never feel a sense of strandedness. That's why many times physical ailments are the thing that gets our attention, because there are only so far doctors can go. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, there's only so far. Everybody else gets to the water's edge and they can't go anymore with you. Now, it's going to take some water walking faith. There's only so far everybody else can go. But the truth of the matter is, you know this is true about yourself. We don't feel stranded. So this is a great problem, a problem of a lack of desperation. And you notice in the Bible, it's always the desperate ones that got the favor of God. Am I right? The little, the least, the last, the lowly, the lacking, the looked over, the left out, the lost, people who were crushed with a sense of desperation. And so what a challenge. So now Peter's got a challenge. I'm gonna like the rest of the guys, like the other 11 who are conspicuously silent. ain't nobody saying nothing. But old Peter. And we give Peter a hard time. But yeah, but listen, what a challenge. You've got the ship and you've got the Savior, and in between there's this storm. And Jesus gives him this word, come. This word is a challenge. Now Peter's going to have to give up the ship to go to the Savior. And, you know, what is it that I'm holding on so tightly to? Right? That Christ can't be formed in me. What is it that God is saying, hey, open your hand. I think I told y'all the story about a little boy who got his hand stuck down to his mother's vase. It was a priceless vase given to her by her great-grandmother, and it passed down through generations. The little boy had his hand stuck in his mother's priceless vase. And she tried to get that hand free and couldn't. And she tried hot soapy water, and she tried to, and the little boy, it dawned on her, I'm going to have to break this vase. She took a mallet and she broke the vase, and that priceless vase fell to the floor. But when it did, it exposed the hand of that little boy, and it was in a fist. And she said, son, was your hand like this the whole time? Mm-hmm. She said, if you'd have opened your hand, I could have got the hand free. What do you have in your hand? He opened his hand, a little old penny. You know, we laugh at that, but how many times that happened, right? You holding on to some little shiny object. And the invaluable things, the priceless things, fall at our feet because we're holding on to something that don't amount to that much. Maybe you're not holding on to it in your hand, but you're holding on to it right here. Some little something that's keeping us from having the life of Christ formed in our lives. I mean, God is requiring it of us. God is challenging us with it. And we give up that which is priceless for a little old penny. So, I mean, think about this. Your life. What is it that God is after now? What is it that I need to unhand? What is it that I need to... You know, I talk about this whole principle of living with the open hand. The open hand says, God, put in what you want, take out what you want. Right? My life is lived like an open hand. I'm not holding on to anything. In my hand, no price I bring. In my hand, nothing I hold. My life is an open hand. And you put in what you want, you take out what you want. That's a challenge. Peter had to unhand the ship. It wasn't much in that sea. They were... But I'm going to tell you something. It was something. And it would have kept him from this great water walking adventure, walking with Jesus. And so to Peter's credit, he was challenged by that. And we know that he did exploits by the grace of God because of that. But the word come is not only a challenge. The word come is a call. God's always got a call on my life, got a call on your life. It's always a call upward, and God's call is always to himself. God wasn't just saying, Peter, you get out here, you can walk on the water. No, he says, come. Come. This is what God is after, Brother Larry. God is after, like, come. The miracles or the miracle of walking on the water is secondary. Primarily, it's move closer. Come. You know what I'm saying? Like, come. It's a call. Now, you've got a call on your life. God is saying, come. He's challenging you to unhand whatever it is that keeps you from coming. There's a call on your life. He's calling you to come up higher, come to where he is. Remember, he's using the sea to move closer to them, but he's also using the storm for us to move closer to him. This thing works both ways. He'll walk to us on our storm, but he wants us to walk to him in our storm. And there's a call. Come. But it's also a command, right? The word come is a command. When Jesus says come, now not to come is disobedience. And so, bid me come to thee on the water, Jesus says come. Command me to come. Come. That's a command. It's a challenge. It's a call. It's a command. And not to come. So, you know, we talk about the call of God in our lives as if we have options, don't we? Well, you ain't got no option. I don't have an option. The Lord bid me come to him. The Lord calling me closer. I have no option not to walk closer. And we're all as close as we really want to be, right? But we're not as close as he wants us to be. So there's this always this word come that's on my life today. Come, tomorrow, come, come. Giving us a command, come. Yoke, get in the yoke, the easy yoke. Come, walk with me, come. And that's a command. It's no options. You don't say to the judge, well, I know you invited me to court, but I got this. That ain't no invitation. That's a summons. Right? I mean, the judge don't just invite you. And the King of Glory don't just invite you. When the Lord says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. Yes, that's an invitation, but it's a command. And people sin against God by not coming. They're not just sinning against an invitation. You remember the story over in Matthew, what is it, 22, where the master, for the king called for the folk to come, Matthew 22. He made a dinner for his son, a nice banquet, and sent out servants, told them to come, and they would not. And he was wroth. He was angry. I mean, the king calls you, and you say no. So the Lord has this call on my life. And what am I saying no to the Lord about today? I have to ask myself this question. So Peter unhands the ship to walk through the storm safely. And it's a matter of choice, by the way. Peter says, I'll choose the ship or I'll choose the Savior. He chose the Savior. And I love this. He says, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, you got to give Peter an attaboy. He walked on the water to go to Jesus. I was talking to my good friend Dean, and I were talking yesterday, and he was talking about a sermon he preached recently about fear and faith. And I don't know whether I can quote this right, but fear and faith have something in common. It's not the same thing, though. Fear and faith, both fear and faith have some, you know what it is they have in common? Focus. Think about it now. Am I doing it right? They both have something in common. Fear has something in common with faith. It's the same thing, but it's in a different place. What is it? Focus. Fear focuses on something, and faith focuses on something. Yeah. Anytime there's a sustained fear in my life, I'm not talking about some startling something that makes you afraid. I'm talking about sustained fear. I'm living in fear. I can guarantee you that's an indication that I'm focused on the wrong thing. Right? Remember the light on the dashboard ain't your problem. It's indicating a problem. So fear is that light. Anxiety many times is that light that comes on the dashboard saying you got a trust problem. You got a focus problem. And I'm tempted so often to walk around in fear and in dread. I've got a focus on the wrong thing. Faith has the same kind of a thing. It focuses. But what does faith focus on? Focuses on the Lord. And so here when the Bible says Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to do what? To go to Jesus. See, when my goal is what his goal is, when I want for myself what he wants for me, right? Dr. Aidan Rogers used to say, we would all want for ourselves what God wanted for us if we had sense enough to want it. Our problem is what? We don't have sense enough to want for ourselves what he wants for us. But let me just say this. He walked on the water not to prove to the other guys he could. He walked on the water not to show that he had more faith than everybody else. He wasn't just showing off. He walked on the water to do what? To go to Jesus. Bid me come to thee. Come. Now, how many of y'all know that if I say go, there's 1,000 places you can go? But if I say come, ain't but one place you can come. That's here. Right? We can go as many directions as there are people in here. As many places that we're going. We all going to different places. But to come, we all come to one place. And Jesus is always saying, come. And so Peter walked down and he walked on the water to go to Jesus. How many know that more than walking on the water, Peter was walking on the word come? Now watch this. Peter's faith was not just accurate, it was active. I will say this to the folk in here who love to read the word of God and love to cross T's and dot I's. That some people, man, nothing stimulates them like a good old Bible discussion on doctrine. I mean, that's really, in many respects, that's how we measure our Christianity today. How well you believe this or that. And Christian people who ought to be loving one another, spending time spatting about the finer issues of theology. And that's how we get our groups. You know what I'm saying? I don't even know whether I can fellowship with you because you might be amillennialist or premillennial. Some of y'all don't even know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can't fellowship with you because you are wrong on this finer issue. And that's how we measure ourselves. You're charismatic. I'm non-charismatic. Well, I'm a Calvinist. Now, Calvinists say, well, I'm a five-pointer. Well, I'm a seven-pointer. Well, that's where fellowship breaks in right there. You know what I'm talking about? I read the ESV. You read the King James Version. We argue over stuff like that. That's a big, big, big deal to us because that's how we measure our Christianity. We don't measure it, do I love Jesus? David says, I'm a companion of all them that keep thy law. You love the Lord. You walking in obedience, we can fellowship. And it ought not be over, you know, it ought not be banter. You don't, now as old John back there in the Navy and I'm a Marine, and so we always give a little banter, some of you Navy guys, Air Force guys, I don't even know why I'm talking about the military, why even bring up the Air Force? But anyhow, but let me just tell you this. No, really, Really, though. When the rockets and the bombs are falling and all that, ain't nobody squabbling over that kind of stuff. You follow what I'm talking about? I mean, we've got business. We've got more that unites us than more that divides us. And we used to say in the Marine Corps, nobody's in the foxhole arguing because the beans are cold. That's the kind of stuff people back here in the United States in nice warm barracks is arguing about. The beans are cold. But in the foxhole, when the fight is on, you ain't arguing about cold beans. So before I close, let me just say this. Sometimes we spend our time crossing T's and dotting I's, and the accuracy of our faith is so important to us. But an accurate faith is not an active faith. It's a dead faith. His faith was accurate. Lord, bid me come to thee on the water. You get me to do it. It is to Jesus. Jesus has the power. It was accurate faith, but it was active. He got out of the ship. So sometimes my Baptist brothers give Pentecostal brothers a hard time. Pentecostals believed it. Like Baptists ain't getting out of the ship. We want the Pentecostals to get out the ship. Baptists going to be in the ship arguing about what does that mean in the Greek. Come now. Wait a minute now. Is that it? What tense is that? Is that what the Greek word for come? Crossing T's and dotting I's in the ship. While the people who believe God are walking on the water. God help us. This don't mean it's not important to know what you believe and why you believe what you believe. We need to learn more and more and more. You follow what I'm telling you? But I'm just telling you, friend, it's time for us to believe God. And if I believe God, I'll unhand what I got in my hand. And I'll walk where he has given me a command to walk, even if it's on the water. I can't understand it. Doesn't seem to make sense, but he told me I can and I will. And I won't let little stuff keep me. I mean, listen, you find out throughout this Bible, there are people who engage in all kind of religious talk that never did anything. Saul, the first king of Israel, he talked about God. Oh, bless the Lord, all these things. Oh, you remember when David was about to fight? Oh, the Lord be with you. Well, the Lord would have been with you if you'd have went. You know what I'm talking about? It's just religious talk. So God help us to be not just accurate, but active. Amen? Hey, let me go on to close for today. Father, thank you so much for your goodness, Lord. Thank you for these men. Lord, thank you for your Holy Spirit who is teaching us today. Help us. Help me to be more than just someone who would stand up here and presume to teach things that I would not seek to live by. So do the work in our hearts. God, you said you would. We thank you that you will. That work in our hearts that needs to be done. We pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.